something like happened in the 1930s. Do I think we're in that? Yes. What we're dealing with now is just money and credit. It is a stress test. The world will be very different. There'll be a new world order. There are three stages, really, in monetary policy. And the cycle that we are in, the whole world cycle, began in 1945. That was the beginning of the New World Order. 1944, we established the dollar as the world's reserve currency. It was connected to gold. And then until 1971, that broke up. And so there was an arc in which central banks have the capacity to produce demand by producing credit. Just sort of hit a button and poof, and demand rises because credit comes out. But when interest rates no longer are effective and hit zero, as they did in 2008, you go to a monetary policy, which I call monetary policy two, which is the printing of money and the buying of financial assets. And with that, there was the implications of that. Lots of liquidity in the world, bidding up asset prices. And we had an environment which was very good for capitalism, corporate tax cuts. All of that caused asset prices to rise. And then, of course, it also contributes to the wealth gap. The long-term debt cycle and monetary policy is an overarching influence. It's important to understand where we are in that cycle. Related to that cycle is also the wealth gap cycle. Periods of prosperity that occur after wars, during periods of peace. There are periods of peace because there's a dominant power that no one wants to fight, and you have a prosperous period. And during those periods, there's a lot of development of credit, a lot of also expansion of prosperity and so on, technology development, and that creates wealth gaps. And then along with those wealth gaps, values gaps and political gaps. And so that influence is a giant influence. So that's number two. And then number three as the major influence is the rise of a great power to challenge the existing world leadership of the United States. And these cycles have happened over periods of time. That competition, that wars of various types, trade wars and the like, is another factor. So those factors are in place and were in place before we had the virus. The virus came along and is a knockback, and it has big financial implications. In the normal world, at normal times, the way the system works is central banks put money on deposit, and banks come along and they borrow that money and lend it to those who they expect will pay back. And that then passes through the credit system, and then all financial assets compete with each other, and it spreads out, credit gets expanded, and then there's the issue of payback, and then we have the cycles. Money's too loose, inflation rises, central banks put money on, tighten money, and it slows down, and we go through our cycles. That's no longer the case. Today, the economy and the markets are driven by the central banks and the coordination with the central government. What I mean by that is the purchases right now of financial assets by the Federal Reserve, or the purchases by the Federal Reserve of government securities, are the drivers of that market. So the production of the money, if you look at money and you look at who is in the market, so the Federal Reserve, for example, will set an interest rate that for different types of creditors based on its economic objective. In the old days, let's say when we had the 2008 financial crisis, we needed to protect banks because they were systemically important, and then money market funds and commercial paper and the like. Now it's much broader than that.
Hey, wait, please subscribe the channel. It will inspire me to make more videos and make my day phenomenal.
The whole economy is systemically important. If they didn't go out and make lending to companies, including what we call fallen angels, those that were just above investment grade and fell into investment grade, we would lose large parts of our economy. And so we're in a situation now where they're the market makers. Take the market out, take the central banks out, and you have a different story. Think about it in Europe, for example. The central bank will lend to banks at a minus 1%. So that means you don't have interest payments. In fact, you have interest credits. And the central banks will take that debt on. They'll own it. And they have a political agenda, not a economic agenda, in which they'll determine whether they'll be paid back or when they want to be paid back based on how the economy is doing and what will happen. So in that case, like an example in Europe and the similar situations in the United States and Japan in varying degrees, they will make loans that will have interest credits almost, or let's say zero, you don't have to pay interest back. And you may not have to pay principal back. It depends on what the conditions are at the time. So those are markets which are driven by central banks, not only their actions, but their desire to be an owner of those assets, and their priorities about that ownership when they buy and when they sell are not the same as the classic free market allocations. And as a result, the capital markets are not free markets allocating resources in the traditional ways. The limiting factor has to do with the demand for that money and debt. In other words, what debt is, a bond, is a promise to receive a lot of currency. And so when it gives no good return and there's a printing of a lot of currency, clearly it's not desirable relative to other things for private investors. However, the central bank can buy it too. And so the limit has to do with the limit of demand. And that limit of demand has to do with the central bank's purchases of that because they could buy it and hence there's no problem. So you look at periods of time of where in history, where was the most of it that has ever taken place? And the war years was an example, or I think the most analogous period we're in now was 1930 to 1945. You first had the depression, and in that depression, and when you hit zero interest rates, you had the printing of money and the buying of financial assets, and then you had a lot of fiscal policy, so programs that produced large deficits, which then were monetized by more of that. And then you went into the war years, and the war years, very similar to now in terms of the need for a lot of money and credit, produced an enormous amount of money and credit, but it was managed by the central bank in a way where they were de facto taking that on. It was a good example of testing the limits of that. Now we went into periods where, you know, what is an alternative source of wealth? And as I say, it could be stocks, gold, it could be other assets, but those became the boundaries. What would happen in terms of this limit is if something transpired where the dollar as a reserve currency, the holders outside, made another market that was a better market. It could be gold, it could be stocks, but when that happens, and I think it will happen, then it looks like a currency defense. If money leaves that asset, if those who are holding bonds don't want to hold the bonds because they have lousy returns and they're printing a lot of money and they want to go to something else, and that starts to accelerate, should that happen, then what that does is it puts the central bank in the position of having to decide whether it buys more bonds in order to fill in that gap, or it lets interest rates rise. Well, they can't let interest rates rise. There's too much debt, and then also interest rates rising means that the asset prices all go down and it's too vulnerable. So like all currency defenses, what it means is that they then have to accommodate that. And the act of accommodating that in and of itself is a big problem. Should that happen, that would be terrible for the United States. Earlier I heard about the discussion of the privilege. That's right, the United States dollar is a tremendous privilege, and we are certainly pushing the limits of that. And if we were to think that the dollar was to be any other currency because of us pushing the limits, if that were to happen, it would be probably the biggest disruptor, not only to the markets, but to the whole world geopolitical system.
If you liked the video, a sub to the channel would be incredible, and also share the video to spread the word. You can watch another video, just click left or right. Keep inspiring.